Hi. I actually became an entrepreneur because of my father. When I was 16 years old, I wanted to go out. And my father said, you can go out, but you'll be home at 12. And I said, Dad, come on, it only starts at 12. He said, I don't really care, you'll be home at 12. And I thought, well, that's not good. So I was thinking creatively, how can I deal with this? And I went to my father and I said, well, if I organize a party, can I then stay longer? And he said, well, if you organize the party and you learn something, you can stay longer. And so I started organizing parties. Every week one. But well, in the beginning, I only had one per week, per month. And then after a while, I said, well, this is not good. And so I started organizing parties every week. And very quickly, I had parties all over the place. So I organized parties in my hometown, but also in other towns and so on. So at the end of the day, I had pretty much concerts with a lot of the Belgian artists, so learned a lot from it. It was a lot of fun. And then I started my studies, and unfortunately, my parents were not very rich, so I had to work. And so I worked 30 hours a week when I was studying. I studied political and social sciences. And so that was not very good, because I didn't have time at that point in time to really go to the lessons. And I thought, well, this is not going to work either. But I had a very good friend. And she was very good because she took notes, and she had all these kind of powerful colors, and she even had the jokes of the professors in her notes. So I thought, that is good. So I made a deal with her, and I said, well, I'm going to buy you dinner, but you will have to give me the notes, and I have to be able to actually start commercializing the notes. And so I started in the University of Antwerp, the student courses, which was quite good. I had the notes of all the lessons, not only from political and social sciences, but also law, economics, and then I also got the exams questions, which was also kind of handy. And so I actually, when I left the university, I sold this company, small company, we had about 10 million copies, and I sold it to the university, which was kind of fun. So that was my first experience in entrepreneurship. And the good news is I had money then, so I had time, and so I became the president of the faculty union, as they call it. But the problem was, it was a very small faculty. They had about 200 people. We never ever gave any big party, and so the money on the account was completely empty. So I became president of an empty faculty in terms of money, and I said, well, this is not going to work either, so let's do something about it. And so I organized the Night of the Erotics, which was kind of cool. You can imagine in a Catholic university. But it was very good, because we had about 3,000 people coming. We only had 1,000 people room, so we sold a lot of tickets. And we became, from the poorest, let's say, faculty in town, we became the richest faculty in town. So that was good. But then the professors didn't really like me for it, because I organized it 4 times. And so at the end of my career at university, I thought, well, I have to go and find a job, so I have to start doing something decent. And so I started organizing classical concerts, which was also fun, because it was pretty fun, because the profit of the classical concert, and we did that 8 times, was actually spent in champagne. So we bought 3,000 bottles of champagne, and we drank all night, and it was a lot of fun. So anyway, you'll see drinking and beer is a kind of red line in my career. But anyway, then I got serious, and I got children. So these are actually my own children. Pretty cool, eh? Yeah, I agree. But my son today is 16, and my daughter is 14, so they're a bit older. But when they were younger, they were having Pampers, and I thought it was ridiculously expensive. I don't know about you guys, but I thought it was expensive. So I looked into the internet, and I found a place in Germany where they didn't have any more Pampers. There was a bankruptcy, so I bought the bankruptcy Pampers, put it on a train, a whole like container, and then got all the Pampers dumped into my attic, and I start selling Pampers to my neighbors. It's true. Yeah. Even today, when I walk, it's 15 years later, and I go to the Lezo or something, they still ask me, do you have Pampers? So I know I don't have any Pampers anymore, so I'm still the Pamper guy in Sint-Kathleen-en-Waver, because I don't live far from here. So anyway, then I went with my wife and kids to Thailand, and we were in a city where they make these coconut bowls. And my wife said to me, you have to do something for these people. I said, well, okay, so I bought 18,000 of these things. I'm not kidding. I still have 12,000 left on my attic. So if anybody of you guys want coconut balls, I'm the guy. Anyway, Then I became a bit serious, or a bit more serious, so I started my career in private equity, which basically means getting money and investing it in technology companies. And so so I worked a lot in the US, and some from time to time we had to invest in the US. So I called the guys at the bank where I worked, and I said, okay, send me some money. And what struck me was that it was very expensive to get money from one point to the other, but it was also, it took a lot of time. And actually one day, they lost my money. So I said, what's happening? So I called the girl in the bank and I said, where's my money? And she said, well, don't worry, it's in the financial system. I said to her, what do you mean it's in the financial system? And she said to me, well, the financial system is like a big black box. So you go, you enter the money, and then you pray, and you hope one day that it pops up. And I thought, well, that's really funny. So I thought, I want to learn more because I'm very curious. I didn't know anything about payment systems, but I'm just a curious guy. So I went and I said, I want to learn something. And there's actually three things I learned from the financial system. First one, the banks, and not only banks, but also electricity companies, all companies are based in silos. So they're silo-based. So you see a director which is responsible for a certain silo in payments, international payments, domestic credit card, debit card, and so on. And each of that guy has built technology, has bought technology, a validation system, a settlement system, a limit check to the accounting systems, and all of that. And his neighbor, which he doesn't talk to, has done the same but with different technology. And so if you look at it holistically, you actually see all these things, duplication. And so that's the first thing I saw, silos and duplication of processes, very inefficient. The second thing I saw was that each of these silos have their own database. It's really funny because sometimes as a client of a bank, you can be in one database with a certain address and maybe with a certain wife, and in the other database, you can have another address. I'm not talking about the other wife, anyway. So the second thing was duplication of data. And the third thing I saw was that if you look into banks, banks have channels, you know, the branches and internet channels and all of that, so each of these channels has to be linked with each of these silos, which basically gives you like spaghetti on top. So that's the third thing I saw. And I thought, well, this is funny, because if you think about a real-time world where you have to interact and send money, this is not never going to work. And that we're talking 99. And so I came up with an idea. And as I said, beer is an important factor. So I went with my friends to a pub, and we said, how can we solve this? And it's not rocket science, by no means of stretch of the imagination. But it's just taking out everything that is common, taking it out and building it into a horizontal layer, and tying it once with the front end and putting it on a centralized database. So you get rid of the data, you get rid of the processes, and you put everything on one centralized. And that's basically my company. That's what I started in 2000, which was a company called Clear2Pay. And so it was a lot of fun, I can tell you that. We had 23 offices, 1,200 employees, and we worked for a lot of the largest banks. So that's my story as an entrepreneur. And so a lot of people still today ask me, well, how did you do it? And what are your lessons? And give me some tips. And basically, the idea now is to give you a couple of tips, actually six to be correct, some takeaways that I would like to share with you. Takeaway number one. Now, this is a report, or it's not from my son, but imagine if you would be coming home with this report. You have a 6 on 10, 7 on 10, 9 on 10, 8 on 10. What would your typical Flemish mother say to you? Anybody? Well, my mother would say to me, the 6 has to be better, typically. And so as a kid, you listen to your mother and you say, okay, 6 has to be better. You start doing effort in the 6, but you don't really like it because you had a 6 for a reason. And so because you're doing effort in the 6, you might get the 6 up to a 7, maybe to a 7.5. But while you're doing this, the 9 and the 8 goes to 7 because your time is limited. You cannot spend enough time on it. And so, in fact, if you look at it historically, we are all trained to be average because you're getting average. And average is not bad if you're competing with the guys next to the other church, but if you're competing with the rest of the world, average is not good enough anymore. And so, in other words, myself, I've always didn't really care about average. And so when I had, for instance, in the bank evaluation, they spoke for an hour evaluation, and they talked 50 minutes on what I did wrong. I was very bad at this and this and this and this. And then they talked like 5 minutes on what I was good. And I told the guys in HR, I know that I'm very bad at this, and I don't have any attention whatsoever in the world to actually improve it. I only are interested in the 5% and what I'm good at, and I want to become the best in the world and work with other guys who are the best in the world to make the best of the world company. No. So the fact is, you have to focus on your talent. So that's number one. Takeaway number two. A lot of people work serial. So they start their career, they work, they hope they get better, and they get more paid, but they always believe and they stay in the same sector. And they always work one at a time and then they move on. I'm personally a big fan of not serial, but parallel working. I've always done it. I've done three things at the same time. I don't have ADHD. But while I'm working, I'm very focused, but I do three things at a different time in different sectors. Because I do stuff in different sectors, I get to know people from different sectors, but also I get experience. And if you work in parallel and you compare with somebody who works serial, after 3-4 years, you have so much more experience than people are looking at you and saying, hey, this guy is really smart. But you're not smart. You have just more experience. And so for me, the crux of the matter is to try not to work serial, but work parallel in your life. So that's number two. Number three. Before it was all about knowing. And I still remember if you wanted to know something, you had to go to the library. You have to be lucky that the book was still there and that somebody else didn't have the book. So it was all about knowledge. It was all about knowing. And you had to know it in your head. And today, and this is actually, I came home to my wife with an animal like this. I'm not exaggerating. It was this big. And my wife said, what are you doing? I said, well, I'm going to cook and I'm going to clean squid. And she looked at me and she said, cooking squid and cleaning squid, you don't know how to do this. I said, you're right, I don't have a clue. But I have something. I have this thing here in my pocket, my phone. And actually, there's YouTube movies, you should check it out, on how to clean up squid. And it's really funny because if you don't do it in the right way and you do one, the other, and you mix up, you can actually destroy the meat. Now, the point of the matter is it's not about knowing. It's about applying knowledge, and it's about how to apply knowledge. And I think today that's really important, not to think about too much about knowledge, but really about applying knowledge. So that's number three. Number four, proprietary. Before, everybody was building software. I was building software, and banks were buying it, and they wanted to own and keep the software. And I was talking with a guy from a bank, a CIO, and he said to me, oh, we're a very important bank. Look at us. We have 3,000 developers. And I said, well, 3,000 developers, that's a lot. And I looked at him, and I said, well, it's great, but I have 10,000 developers. And he looked at me and said, oh, cool, cool. What kind of company are you work for? Google, Apple, or whatever? I said, no. I work for me, myself, and I. And he looked at me and he said, how can you work for you, yourself, and I and have 10,000 developers? And I said to him, well, there's something like open source. Because open source allows you, if you're creative as a person and you sit on your attic again and you have this great idea, you can actually put the open source out or your idea out to the open source. And you can have developers from all over the world, from Apple, Google, and think, oh, this guy's idea is very creative, very cool, and I'm going to help in the evening to work on it for free. So I don't have to pay the people, but I get 10,000 people who help me to make my software. And so that way I can build software, and I can actually create something where before you needed to have money, you needed to have influence, you needed to be a child of a big guy industrial to be successful. But now, today, you can, if you're a creative idea, with open source, you can become successful. And obviously, that's something that I've really tried and worked on it. Number five. We all talk about disruption. The world is going to end, and we're all going to be disrupted. I'm not a big believer of disruption. And I don't know if there are any economists here in the room, but I don't know if any, maybe somebody knows something about the law of Ricardo. You should check it out also. It's on the web. Now, Ricardo was an economist. He lived in Scotland. And he saw basically that the Scots were using a lot of the capacity of the country that they had to build wool or to make wool. And they were doing it very efficient. But he also saw that they were using some of the capacity to make wine in a very inefficient way. And then Ricardo took his boat and he went to France and he saw just the opposite in France. He saw that the French were using a lot of the capacity to make great wine, but they also were very shitty at making wool and they were using a part of the capacity to do that. And Ricardo said that doesn't make any sense. Everybody should do what they're good at. The French should make wine, the UK guys should make wool, and they should actually just trade. And you can check it out. On the internet, you have all these kind of complicated calculations that show you how the law of Ricardo works. And that's exactly what I mean with technology. Technologists, guys, should focus on technology. Banks, financial institutions should focus on what they're good at, and they should trade, they should work together, they should collaborate, they should create ecosystems. And so that's also something I would like to talk to you about and tell you. Number six. I love this one. It's great. What makes a company successful? Anybody? Sorry? People, of course, people. Anyone, anything else you need? Sorry? Belief, that's a good one, belief, yes. But if you read the management books, nothing else, I mean, just people and that's it? Ideas, yes. Vision, okay.
Enthusiasm.
Enthusiasm, yeah, okay. Well, I'll tell you, typically if you read the management books, that's what you will read. You need a product, you need a big market, you need money, and you need a team. Those are the four typical elements. But I can tell you there's a fifth element. And the fifth element, that's time. The best technology companies and the best companies in the world are the ones who are capable of squeezing and reducing time. And so squeezing time is something funny, it's something strange, but let me give you an example. If companies want to have an ERP system, what do they do typically? They have six people from their division coming together, they work on it, they go for seven vendors, they work for 6 months, and then they make a report to the board and they say, okay, this is the vendor we should choose. And guess what? In 80% of the chance of the times, the vendor that they want to choose is the same. So if somebody would have told them in the beginning, don't do all this work, don't spend 9 months and all this money, but just take this vendor, they would have saved time. And so everything you do, everything I do, my principles is in companies is about helping and finding ways to save time, because that's the crux of the matter. And so anything in your personal life or in your company life, you should figure out, how can I save time? Now, the good news is technology is the best thing to save time, because with tools, if you apply them right, you save time. And so, I still have 1 minute left, so what are the key takeaways for today? First of all, don't forget, focus on your talents. Second, try to work parallel in your life. Three, don't forget open source. Four, apply your knowledge. Five, it's all about the law of Ricardo. And six, the crux of the matter is how to save time. And there's actually a seventh element, which I forgot about, and that's you have to have fun in life because life is way too short. Thank you.